Greetings, everybody. This is a recovery from African Radio Salone. Right now, we are on the Salone OnBLAST network. Welcome to the Salone OnBLAST. We are here in the studio with a special guest, and we are about to go direct to that person. This person is very, very influential in our entertainment industry, has been a frontier in this entertainment industry, in the Salone entertainment industry. So without wasting ado, I want to introduce Mr. Jimmy Bongo. How are you doing, my brother?
I'm blessed, my brother.
Thank you. Well, this is the Salone OnBLAST network, and we are officially putting you on blast at this point. What Salone OnBLAST is an entertainment network where we can showcase our entertainers, not only in the entertainment perspective, and get to know a little bit about them, their personal life, and just showcase them as
how personal.
Not too personal, okay. But just enough so that the people will know exactly who you are, where you're from, and where you go. But thank you again for coming to Salone.
Well, thanks for the invite.
You're welcome, sir. Well, let us start this by first of all having a short history. Talk about where you were born and where you grew up in your initial life.
All right. Well, my name is Jimmy Yeni Pangura, and I was born in Freetown, Wilberforce, to be exact. And I grew up in Wilberforce, and when my father passed on, I think I was about 11 years old, and then I moved on. I started traveling to different parts of Africa, trying to make my way to, obviously, the States, in search of greener pastures. But everything, my whole life, you know, my early stage life started, you know, was in Freetown and Wilberforce.
Great. So it's safe to say you are one of those Wilberforce boys that they always say.
I'm one of those, yeah, I guess so, yes.
Great. That is great. I too can identify because I have a lot of friends that grew up in Wilberforce.
Okay.
Very close community. A lot of people know each other.
Yeah.
Great. Well, growing up in Wilberforce, what really stood out, growing up in that community, what really stood out that you can remember?
Really, like every area in Sierra Leone, I mean, growing up as a kid, you know, you have your friends, you know, people that you associate yourself with, you know, but the lifestyle really is basically the same as you find in Morintown or the eastern part of Freetown.
Here's a story that I must tell. My mama lifted me from hell. I was hurt, but now I feel no pain. I was dead, but now I'm alive again.
Friends that we used to hang out with, play football, and just living day to day, you know, I mean, like every normal kid, you know, in Africa. I mean, obviously, I came from a very disadvantaged background, so we didn't have all the luxury that most people had, you know. Like I was saying to you guys earlier, you know, I had to walk to school, be a food set and all of that. So life wasn't all a bed of roses, you know, but, you know, I enjoyed it, you know. I think that lifestyle, you know, growing up, gave me, you know, a better footing, you know. Just now where I'm at, I'm able to look back and say, you know what, I appreciate my life now and thank God for His glory. Because I came from a very disadvantaged background, humble background, and I'm here today. Praise is due to God.
Great. I admire that. You know, it takes somebody with strength to go through maybe some of the disadvantages that you lived in and still come out successful as you have been. So that is definitely remarkable. But I want to ask you, since now you're so involved in the entertainment industry, what really inspired you at that time, or when did you really see that you had this music bug or the entertainment bug in you?
Believe you me, growing up, I never thought myself to be a musician or an actor. It was something that just came about. It was just very spontaneous. But like every other child, you know, in Sweden back in the days, we used to imitate the Jacksons, you know, the Lionel Richies and all of that. And, you know, so it was part of us. But I didn't think I was going to become a musician. I didn't think I was going to be an actor. It was just something that came, you know, about.
Stand on top of the chair.
What?
You heard me. Stand on top of the chair.
No. People will stare at me. They'll think I'm crazy.
If you love me, you wouldn't mind what people think. Don't know what she said.
A young man from the coast of West Africa had a plan in his head, he would make it far. Made his way to the UK, but slept on the streets and hit by the railway.
One more test.
Don't tell me to take off my pants.
Of course, no.
Then what?
Dance.
Dance to what?
Just dance. Dance.
And it came about in a very funny way, because I left Sweden like in 86 and moved to LA. Most of my friends in LA were musicians, so they would invite me to the recording studio, and every time I go there, you know, I would see what they were doing, and in such I got inspired by them. So it wasn't something that was planned.
Okay. Great. That is admirable also. Having your experience from living in Africa, coming to LA, I believe, how old were you then?
I was 16, 17, yeah. 16, yeah.
So you were still a teenager.
Yeah, many years ago. And don't let anybody know that, yeah.
Great. And you know, I'm kind of trying to look at how different it would have been for you to just leave Sierra Leone at that age. And coming to the U.S. for the first time, seeing a whole new life, basically.
To be honest, it wasn't easy. Like everything else in life, nothing comes easy. But if you're determined, you know, I always tell people, be determined, be focused, and above all, have the fear of God. You know, once you have those three ingredients, you will definitely make it. So it wasn't easy, but I knew once I said to myself, this is what I wanted to do. You understand? I knew I would definitely be a success. Without being arrogant about it, I was just very confident.
Here's the deal, honey. This is real. I speak my mind, girl, I'll tell you how I feel. No doubt, see, I love you to the bone. But I'm not so in the beat, make a day on me own.
You know, it can happen to anybody.
Yes. That is true. That is wonderful. I think you as an entertainer has definitely come a long way, and where you are presently shows the amount of work that you've done. But I want to ask you something really about the music side, because I know you've been doing this for a while, and your very first album, first of all, what was the name of that very first album? If I'm to give you,
I'm sure you're thinking about Jika Jika, but Jika Jika was not my first album.
Well, you see, that's why I'm asking.
The first record I did was called Def Jam in Stereo. I did that in LA, and I used to sell it from the back of my car. I had a Honda CB car that I think I bought it for like $150. This, the dog wouldn't even look, you know what I mean? And it was orange Honda. Whenever I drive, you know, like, you know, I do my hands like this, and I'm like, so that the door doesn't open, you know? But it was, I enjoyed those days, you understand? And I used to sell my CDs from the back of that little Honda. That's how I started. And then I did a record called My Story, which I released in South Africa at a song called You Gotta Believe, which was a hit. And then I think Jika Jika and everything else. So Jika Jika was really the third album, but it was the one that really just blew up.
Right. And I myself, that was the time I really started to hear about the Jimmy, this great man from Sierra Leone. But I believe, like you said, you were in South Africa.
Yes.
And I can remember distinctively some of the events that we used to have at the National Stadium, at the Bullfish Hotel. That's when those Jigga songs became such a hit.
Yeah.
I mean, people used to go crazy about it, and to know that it was a Sierra Leone brother, people were used to be excited about it. So that definitely was when the people of Sierra Leone started to see the impact in the music. But let's talk a little bit about when you came to Sierra Leone, when you left South Africa. First of all, when did you come back to Sierra Leone?
From South Africa, I think, to stay was in 1999-2000.
Okay.
But before then, I'll go back and forth. Because you know, as you rightly said, I used to put up shows at the National Stadium, even though we had, you know, we're going through this terrible period of civil war and all of that. But I just believe that I had to be, you know, some sort of a vehicle for the less fortunate, because I knew that we in Sierra Leone had talent in abundance, but unfortunately we don't have the necessary structure to enable the up and coming artists to showcase the talent that God has blessed them with. And because I was fortunate enough to go out there and make a name for myself and, you know, just, you know, basically achieve, I wanted to come back home and share. So between 1994 to 1999, I was back and forth in Sierra Leone. Like, I brought Shaka Bundu and all the slaves and all of that to perform at the National Stadium. But I set up the studio, Paradise Studio, I think it was 1999 or 2000. So that's when I really decided I'm back home for good.
You came into my life, you took my pain away. Since you came into my life, and I no more rainy day.
And so that's when really this, if I should say, a revolution in the music industry started, because it's when you came to Sierra Leone, you set up your company, and you were able to get a lot of these less fortunate artists. Musicians, like you said, on board. That's when this revolution started.
But you'll have to say that. But yeah, I mean, when I came, I guess, you know, before I came, really, 99.9% of the music that was being played on radio or the videos seen on TV were all foreign based. And obviously, when I did, when we did, you know, Paradise Family Volume 1, that was like the beginning of it, you know, basically. 99.9% of the music that was being played on radio and videos seen on TV was Sierra Leonean. So I guess you could say that's when it all started. I'm going to copy this back home and use it to our own advantage. And he went back home, lo and behold, everything that I told him is what he did. That's when the whole thing started, and look at them now, they're on a different level. Unfortunately for us, because of certain issues and you know, as civilians, we have this tendency that we don't want to go through the process. You know, everybody in a big man,
yeah.
All of a sudden you release a record, a single, you say to yourself, okay, I've made it. You know, you're walking around, people say, hey, that's what you're doing, the asshole, you know. So you think you're better than everybody else, you're God's gift to mankind. You haven't even gone through the process. And as a result, because most of these young kids were thinking along those lines, they basically, one way or the other, messed up the industry. So from this level, the industry started going like this. Not to say that it is, you know, I mean, it can be revived.
Frustration, that your beautiful lips, I can't resist. It's so intoxic, I need a kiss, I insist. True set up, may not for you, I'd have fall. So hear me out when I call.
God, you beautiful, God, you beautiful.
And we just need to get our priorities, set our priorities right. And once that is sorted, that once we have the right structures, the necessary structures in place, then the sky's our limit.
Wait, I felt the need to ask you that question because a lot of people have different views when it comes to what's going on in the music industry. Me too, I kind of think that it went down, the potential is so big that if we focus on that and try to build that, it will take us to that next level, as we always say. But I thank you for that answer. I want us to talk about now this movie business, because it seems like you're a man, I mean, you're of all trades, you're a jack of all trades. Having mastered music, you decided to go into movies. How did this transition happen for you to happen?
Well, it wasn't really a difficult transition, because at the end of the day, it's all entertainment. And when back in the days, I actually used to do a lot of extra work in the movies in Hollywood. You know, like most people know, I was in Coming to America, and I did like MacGyver. I did all these extra work. So it has always been a part of me since I came, you know, migrated to the States.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't a very difficult transition to make. Now, again, I'm grateful to God that I feel blessed, because, you know, it is from God, you know, because it is a gift that, you know, He has blessed, you know, bestowed upon me. So whatever it is, I make sure that I use it to its full potential and make sure that I impact other people's lives through my craft. Now, having said all of that, obviously I was concentrated, you know, more into the music thing. Once I saw that, you know, there are so many other people involved with regards to producers and executive producers, I thought I had done my own beat. Let me do something different. And that's how some I branched into the movie industry. But it wasn't like, okay, a difficult thing to do, you know, because I've always been a part of it.
Great. And to be honest with you, I've seen your productions, very good acting, I should say. I'm a very big fan. Yes, you need to see this man in action. Very good acting.
I'm sorry for all the pain I've caused you.
It's okay. It's okay.
I need help! No one is to approach her by order of the queen.
That is my wife. Stand aside if you want to continue living.
Vast knowledge and experience in the field. But I really feel like, our entertainment industry, both the music industry and the movie industry, needed you at that initial stage, because our industry took time for it to grow and to even be formed. Because back in the days, we used to have one or two musicians, Kalenda, Bonnie Mack, you know, but it was not really an industry, as we should say. It was just one or two people doing against recognition and spotlight. But now it's clear that our industry has come up, and you have a lot to do with that, Mr. GDB. And for that, we want to really commend you and thank you on behalf of ourselves here at Salone on Blast, and then also African Radio Salone. We have been watching you. We should say we have been watching you in a good way. and all your work. But let's wrap this up now in regards to this entertainment industry. I know you have some new projects coming up. Do you have any thing you want to tell the listeners now?
Well, okay, I actually have an album. It was actually supposed to be out in December, and I was going to launch it in the 27th of December. Unfortunately, because of the situation back home, I cannot allow myself to be insensitive, you know, and go ahead with the show while people are dying of this dreadful disease, Ebola. So I've decided to cancel it, and this is basically going to be the very last worldly album, you know. Yeah, that's my decision, and. And if I happen to do another record, it will be gospel, definitely. So, yeah.
So Jimmy B is going gospel. That is so good. I think it's a very, very admirable. That is a calling that every human needs to be doing, because we have that obligation.
He has to be at the center of our life, because without him, we're nothing, and that's the bottom line. And I think my whole life, I've been able to, you know, acquire so many, you know, well, success story, basically, because of him, by his grace. You know, my hard work was by his grace, because without his blessings, without his grace, I won't be here. And that's the bottom line. I truly believe in that, and it's not a cliche, you know. So we have to give back to him. We have to thank him. We have to let him know that, you know, we appreciate him.
You know, I honestly respect that. It makes me even respect you even more, because somebody, a man of faith, has wisdom and be able to make that discernment that this is time for me to do something for him. And I wish you good luck with that.
Thank you very much.
We have to wrap this interview. Do you have any last words?
I hate last words. I'm not even like that. You're going to pass away. No.
Just so that, you know, so those that are watching the industry, and people in the diaspora, any words to them?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I want to, you know, say thanks to is it Salone Online?
Salone OnBLAST.
I want to say thanks to Salone OnBLAST for giving me the opportunity to, you know, speak my mind, and. I want to encourage each and every Sierra Leonean, you know, to basically show love to our people. We have to start to respect one another, love one another, and appreciate one another. And we all have a role to play. Each and every individual have a role to play in the development and progress of their country. And the onus on us to ensure that we speak well of our country. Because one thing I noticed is that a lot of times people always say, Salone, bad country, Salone this, Salone this. But this is the only country we have. We understand their problems, we understand their issues in our country. But show me a country or near a country that hasn't got problems. So instead of saying that we have these problems and this and this and that, let's come together, let's unite and push the country forward, because this is for posterity's sake, for our children, our children's children. So let's continue to build on love. Let's continue to build on progress. Let's continue to help to develop whatever industry. Let's continue to help and develop, support each other, support the music industry, support the film industry. Go back home and make your small contribution, however little that contribution is, will go a long way to bring about progress. Let us love each other. Let us respect each other.
Yes. Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Let us love each other. Let us respect each other. Very powerful words from Mr. Jimmy B right here. Sierra Leonean entertainment icon. This man is very respected in our community. But before we wrap this up, I know this Ebola situation is something, like you said, it has affected your plan in regards to launching your CD, which is commendable. What are your views? Anything you want to say pertaining to the
Obviously, this is, for me, in my opinion, it is the biggest threat to our national development since the war. And it is something that is very serious. We cannot politicize it. We need to unify it in our efforts in combating this disease, because it is dreadful. It is dreadful. It is real. It is there. You know, nobody make no mistake about this. And let us not politicize the whole thing. Because I know people are politicking about this and saying this and that. You know, you don't have to be from this party or whatever party, or you don't have to be from whatever tribe, you know. It is one civilian. We're all one in this. And if we can unify our efforts and come together, then we'll definitely combat this disease and we'll get to the country that we once know, the Athens of Africa.
That is so true. Let us unify in this fight. Just like Mr. Jimmy B has said, Ebola is real. We have to fight to eradicate it. But I also really thank you, sir, for coming on the Salone on Blast. This is the number one station for entertainment. Thank you very much, Mr. Jimmy.
Thank you, my brother. God bless you. Thank you.